viewers, and thank you for joining me for this week's business segment. I am Amelia Martha Nashtimbo, and we are looking at the container terminal dispute between Djibouti and in the Horn of Africa and Dubai. There's a new twist. If I may take you back to July, when Djibouti launched the first phase of Africa's biggest international free trade zone, the $3.5 billion project stretches over 4,800 hectares. That's an area that covers close to 8,970 football fields. Imagine that. And this trade zone is intended to further strengthen the tiny nation's strategic positioning geographically as a trade and logistic hub. But the problem is the 10-year project was launched in partnership with Chinese firms. And this did not go well, obviously, with DP World, which owns a third of the facility. On Monday, Djibouti went a step further and nationalized the Dorale container terminal. Dubai's DP World has vowed to defend its share using legal means. But what's at stake for Djibouti in all this? And what does the country stand to lose or gain by getting a new partner for the container terminal? I put the question to geopolitical and economic analyst Aly-Khan Satchu. Listen.
There are two things that I take away from this. One, it's worth considering that Djibouti is highly indebted. Debt to GDP is about 80%. And I think in many respects, Djibouti was premised on a permanent Ethiopia-Eritrea freeze. Now you're seeing a thawing of relations between those two. I'm just not sure that the numbers are going to stack up. Therefore, my concern in Djibouti's case is that the main creditor is China. And at some point, and this is a signal of stress, in making payments on loans to China, obviously they're not earning sufficiently enough to and want to earn more. And that's telling me we could have a Sri Lanka situation develop here where China might take this port and container terminal as security against loans which are likely to turn sour very, very soon.
Now, this dispute has been ongoing, and this is a 10-year project. What do you foresee in the midterm or in the long run, Aly-Khan?
So, first of all, I think, as I said, Djibouti was built out borrowed money because they believe that they were going to be the port of singular importance from the Bab el Mandeb all the way down to as far as Kenya. That is being eroded. That advantage is no longer there. Everybody else is looking into the ports. We're finding people now investing heavily from the UAE, from the Middle East, and others are coming. So, the traffic that they were predicting is simply not going to be there, in my view. In the medium term, I think they're not going to be able to pay on these loans that they've taken out from China, and then they're going to depend upon the kindness of Xi Jinping. And I think Xi Jinping is going to be very keen on getting his hands on Djibouti because it sits at this very central point where you can control the Bab el Mandeb. I'm very worried for President Goulet. I think he's overstretched. This is a signal that the things are not looking good. And I think, I hope he, for one, was renegotiating his loans with China like Prime Minister Abiy and the President of Botswana seem to have done.
Thank you for your thoughts, Aly-Khan Satchu, analyst and CEO of Reach Management in Nairobi. And moving on to South Africa, where an inquiry into a state capture as the relationship between former President Jacob Zuma and the Guptas has been called. It has confirmed influence peddling. And this week, we learned through a testimony of an official from the National Treasury, Juan Gilliland, that the Gupta-owned media firm scooped 260 million rand from the state, an explosive revelation. And the public inquiry is set to last 2 years, and the ruling ANC is urging more witnesses to take part. But will this public inquiry contribute towards the restoration of investor confidence in South Africa? African Times editor Pietro Mpedi in Johannesburg takes on the question.
It appears like it will contribute because a lot of people were a bit disgruntled, including investors, about doing any business in South Africa because they were complaining that the procurement process was not competitive and that nepotism and corruption were the order of the day. and a lot of companies had basically engaged in what here is known as investment strike, where they put away their money and refrained from investing in the economy. So since all these issues emerged and since the election of President Cyril Ramaphosa as ANC leader in December, we've seen a lot of private sector companies coming on board and meeting on several occasions with government to find solutions to the current employment problems in the country.
And in short, you're saying that the public has faith in the inquiry. Thank you for your thoughts, Pietro Mpedi. And we shall keep an eye on this and more developments on the continent. But that's it from me this week. I am Amelia Martha Nachtimbo. See you next time and online at Amelia Martha 1.